Time now for the odd one out round. It's just one between you this week. A dog in Thailand. Scott Mann, MP. Judith Streng from Texas. And Damien Green. Yes.
Now, Scott Mann, colleague of Johnny's.
Yeah.
And I believe there was an incident where Johnny actually saved his life. From drowning. So I'm guessing that he is perhaps the odd one out in that the other three all float.
Is that right? Did you save his life?
Yeah, I mean, it's just because I thought he had my wallet, actually.
He got sacked from the Tory party, or did he resign?
Damien Green's still an MP. He was Deputy Prime Minister and then had a slight...
There was some porn found on a computer that he had access to. And the other three people featured in the film he was watching.
They've all been rescued at sea, apart from Damien Green, who had to be rescued from a river. He was thrown in as part of a student prank while studying at Oxford University. But more recently, who did Damien Green have a run-in with outside Parliament?
Yeah, so there's a set of protesters that are, like, permanently outside Parliament, so that when anyone goes on TV, they just heckle with... quite amusing abuse, to be honest, some of it. But obviously some of it's not. And Damien Green came off an interview and met this chap who's dressed in a European flag and told him that in a contested field, you are by far the biggest here. No. And he was right.
Let's have a look.
Hello, can I ask how you're feeling about the vote yesterday?
No, you can't, because you've just tried to shout over an interview I've done, like you do everyone else.
I did,
I was
singing.
You are the biggest wanker.
Where did this dog end up at sea?
Australia.
Hawaii. Same 5G company we're talking about.
Not quite. It was spotted last week by oil rig workers in Thailand, 135 miles from shore.
Wow. Oh.
Who threw that stick?
Wow.
And finally, where did Judith Streng from Texas end up in the sea?
On holiday, was it? On holiday somewhere?
Yes, she was on a tour of...
the fjords.
She was in Iceland. She sat down on some ice which had formed in the shape of a throne and was promptly carried out to sea.
How hot is her arse?
The iceberg incident happened a couple of weeks ago, after which the accident-prone granny completed her tour of Europe with a trip to Paris, where she lit a candle in Notre Dame.
Time for the odd one out round. Mm. Paul and Bernard, Antigone, Samuel Pepys, Bernard Cribbins, and some Franciscan monks in Leicester.
Antigone, I don't know anything about that.
I did the play once.
Something to do with your career, Bernard.
Storytelling?
Storytelling.
No. Well, we'll keep going.
We know it. It's to do with holes and burying.
Ah.
Because hole in the ground.
Bernard did a song called Hole in the Ground.
Hole in the Ground, yeah.
How did it go?
There I was, a digging his hole, hole in the ground, so big as all around he was, and there was I. It was Noel Coward's favourite when he did Desert Island Discs. And he said, if you could only have one record, Mr. Carr, which would you take? He said, I'd take Mr. Cribbins doing Hole in the Ground. Why? I could translate it into French as I walked up and down the beach.
True. It's about burying, because Antigone was trying to bury her brother.
Ah.
And her uncle wouldn't let her.
The lesser must be the Richard III burial.
They want to bury him, or they did bury him.
They buried him in a car park.
What we're looking for is an odd one out.
So they've all buried things.
They all put stuff in a hole in the ground, apart from Bernard, who just sang about it.
I actually put a man in there.
Oh, OK, ah, so yes, Samuel Pepys.
There's a clue.
Because it wasn't a man, it was cheese.
Yes.
Yeah.
They all buried someone apart from Samuel Pepys, who buried his cheese, and that's not a euphemism.
His cheese.
Well done.
And Right Said Fred...
Right Said Fred, that finishes somebody getting squashed as well. Yes.
Did you have any hits not involving fatalities?
No, no. No, there were a couple of hymns, but...
In Greek mythology, Antigone buried her dead brother. And how's the story end, Ian?
Badly. It's a Greek tragedy. Everyone dies.
Yeah. So Antigone was sentenced to death to be buried alive.
Yeah, not good.
So she hung herself.
Yeah, and then Bernard did a really funny song about it.
Stop hanging about, Antigone. You're making a mess on the floor.
We just cleaned up last Saturday. We don't want to do it no more.
All together now.
Because they've all buried someone, apart from Samuel Pepys, who buried his cheese to save it from the Great Fire of London. The monks who buried Richard III wore grey garments and were hence known as the Grey Friars, just as those who wore black garments were known as the Black Friars, and the profound thinkers who ate a lot, the Deep Fat Friars.
And so, to round two, the strengthometer of news. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Here's the first one.
That's a cake, isn't it? It's the Great British Bake Off winner, that is. So, there was talk about there being some misogyny. Some people on the internet were very harsh about some of the contestants, I believe.
Go on, what is it now?
We were just going to tell you who the people were. The gentleman on the left is Monsieur Raymond Blanc, the television chef, and he tweeted what appeared to be a sarcastic remark about the winner 24 hours before the winner was announced.
Oh.
And possibly spoilt the whole competition.
But he got it wrong, because it wasn't the winner.
Indeed, he said, you know, French is my second language. Theresa May then phoned up and said, oh, you're... You're some froggy Waller, are you? Well, get out! Get out!
This is what he tweeted. The Great British Bake Off, not much skills, female tears, and a winner so thin who makes me doubt her love for great cooking, comma, baking. Who did that text refer
Ruby.
To?
It Ruby. Referred to Ruby.
That's Ruby.
Ah, yes.
But you can't really tell how thin she is there, because she could have, like, a really massive body under there. Must have more photos of myself taken from that height.
And this is the winner.
Francis. Right. And a lot of Bake Off fans were furious. Yeah. What did former finalist Marianne Boermans compare the situation to? Do you know?
No.
The end of the Crimean War.
She said it was like someone saying Snape killed Dumbledore before you've read the book.
Good grief.
Have you all read
Harry Potter? Is that happening? Yeah. Oh, no. My children and grandchildren are watching this. You've just ruined seven people's childhood.
Well, good. Let's see what Frances said about her personality. My key ingredients are a dollop of randomness, a teaspoon of wonder, a pinch of eccentricity, a drop of serendipity, a handful of curiosity, a fluid ounce of fun,
oh,
and a cup of cold sick. So, this is the grand final of Bake Off, which I watched this week. It was contested by three female cooks, which is odd because I happen to know for a fact that the best bakers are all male and they're all called Greg. One of the finalists, Ruby Tando, received a lot of coverage for her looks. She complained, saying, if I see one more person use the pun doe-eyed, I will personally go to their house and force-feed them an entire Charlotte Royale. Ruby, you're doe-eyed. Yeah. That's doe with an O-U-G-H. If I'm not at home, leave it with my neighbour.
It's now time for the odd one out round. Just one between you this week. Mm. Ming the Mollusk, Glenn Greenwald's phone, Bert Kwok, and the E. coli 0157.
Well, I think it's called Ming the Mollusk because it's 500 years old and dates back to the Ming Dynasty. And scientists found it, didn't know how old it was, killed it.
Killed it.
Yeah.
And then discovered it was the oldest animal that they think has ever lived.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So you can get ill from eating those.
Yeah.
E. coli can make you ill.
Absolutely. Bert Kwok, is it the actor or is it the part he's playing there in the Pink Panther films? It's Kato. It's the actor.
It's the part.
It's
he's
the
playing
part.
Kato.
Give us a clue.
Yeah.
Containing the answer. Oh, cold.
Oh,
cold.
Oh, right, OK. Yes, Kato was hidden in a fridge.
Yes.
He was hiding in a fridge in one of the films, shot in the dark, I think, and he comes bang. So it's about people being put in fridges. The mollusk was put in a, should have been put in a fridge and it would have survived. Kato jumped out of a fridge, he was all right. The E. coli bacteria is all right if you freeze it. And it's the bloke with the phone.
Oh, his phone was hidden.
The fridge thing was right. Everything else was wrong. Yeah, but I'm still going to give you a point because I feel like we should move on.
No, but the other one out was Glenn Greenwald's phone.
No, it wasn't. Stop taking over. You can do that on your radio show, which is on at 3:30.
You've got a radio show.
Monday.
I'm going to write that down.
The odd one out is Ming the Mollusk.
Ming the Mollusk.
All the others have survived a stint in the freezer, except for Ming the Mollusk, who died. Glenn Greenwald, the former Guardian journalist who was involved in the publication of the intelligence emails leaked by Edward Snowden, regularly used to put his phone in the freezer. Why would he do that?
He was worried it would be bugged.
Or security, yes. There's an even more effective place you can put your phone to stop anyone hacking it. Any ideas?
Is that News International HQ?
A martini shaker.
Oh, OK.
E. coli 0157, one of the nastiest strains of E. coli, can survive in the fridge or the freezer. How old were you when you first got colonised by an E. coli bacterium, Janet?
Funnily enough, I had amoebic dysentery when I was 7. And I was actually in hot spice.
How on earth did you get that? I thought I was...
I got it in Fulham. I grew up quite near you, Paul. Yes. I think it's something you sent from Fulham Palace Road to my
I used to send out those parcels all the time.
Ming the Mollusk was an ocean quahog, a type of clam. How easy is it to date a clam?
Well, you have to get them drunk first.
there's an app called Chowder.
You need to watch out for chlamydia, though. It's quite... No, I've never dated a clam before.
No.
Pulled a few muscles. but if nothing else, this story brought out a certain solidarity amongst headline writers. What do you think The Independent, The Mirror and The Mail all went with for their headline?
Clam dead after 500 years. No. That wouldn't be very good, would it? Shuts.
Clam shut. Clam shell, clam shut, clam...
Tears. Cry.
yes. Clam claps my martis. No!
Are you taking the piss? You know what it is now.
No.
You do!
This is what stupid people look like!
I've never seen anyone worse at charades than you.
No.
That is a very good clam mime.
We got the clam
bit. Oh, sorry. The sad bit, the sorrow. What would happen? Oh, damn, it's such a...
A shame.
Crocodile.
Not a shame!
Clarity!
Clarity, Ian!
No, that's terrible.
No, Ian, it's obviously terrible. It's a clarity.
It's terrible.
I'm not mad, am I? You all got that.
What? What were the tears for? How would that lead us to calamity as a
that
pun?
That was useless.
Right, you're all going. You can be the panellist now. Come on.
Fingers on buzzers, teams, for the next one.
Have they shut the Humber Bridge to stop people going to Hull?
To stop people going to Hull?
Yeah.
They don't want any more tourists. They've got enough.
Maybe they're trying a new slogan, Hull, one letter different from hell.
Could be it, couldn't it? Well, you're in the right neighbourhood. Both of you in the right neighbourhood.
John Prescott's from Hull, always MP for Hull.
Yeah.
That's why they just close Hull.
Yes. He's not an MP anymore, is he? Other than being a... Yeah, no, he's
member of the House of Lords.
Oh, right. He's a lord in Hull as well.
Mm-mm. Is he the Lord of Hull?
Well, I don't know.
I am the Lord of Hull!
It is to do with Hull, but it's actually The Economist magazine. They have a very specific view on Hull.
Mm. It should be shut down. Is that what they...
Absolutely right, yes. The Economist magazine thinks that the city should be closed down along with Burnley, Middlesbrough and Hartlepool.
Closed down?
Just closed down.
Why?
The Economist described any efforts to save struggling northern communities as misguided. You lived in Leeds.
Yeah, I was born in Leeds.
Born in Leeds.
Yeah.
Should they close that down?
Leeds is doing very well. It's thriving.
Have you heard of Leeds, Ian?
Yes.
Yeah.
There's a football team in Leeds, isn't there?
There is. Leeds United. Yeah.
You see, local knowledge.
Paul, any view on Leeds?
So good they named it once.
This is The Economist magazine's plan to shut Hull. Grim, dull, and uninspiring. The Economist comes out every week.
Marcus?
It's a woman being inflated on the beach.
Yeah, that's the girl who was accused of being a Russian spy because she went out with a politician. They found she wasn't a Russian spy, she was just a Russian.
Yep, you're quite right.
They thought she was a spy. She used to go into the House of Commons canteen and say, these sausages are rather cold for this time of year. the seagull flies high above Krakow. It sounded like secret messages.
I think they actually thought she was a spy because she made a beeline for a member of the Liberal Democratic Party.
So not very well informed, then?
No. They thought, what other reason could there possibly be?
It's phoning the Kremlin going, they are going to make corduroy compulsory.
Indeed, this is Katia Zyutilyeva, who had...
Oh, you bet you've practised that, haven't you?
Конечно.
Yeah, it was very good.
That's all my Russian.
That's very good. You just learned her name and that was it?
No, конечно, I just said of course.
Bless you. Oh, it was of course as well, blimey.
Здравствуйте. Меня зовут Кирсти. Как тебя зовут?
Oh!
Very good. Very good.
Hold on a minute, I just want to ring MI5.
Yes. You're filling for the oldest trick in the book. We invited you onto this show. This show's not going out this week. These are cardboard figures. That's not Giles Brandy, that's a puppet.
Nice.
For the Muppet Show. If it was.
And so to round two, the strengthometer of news. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Here's the first one.
It's the London Marathon. There was a row with the Guinness Book of Records about whether this nurse should get a record for doing the shortest time dressed as a nurse. And Guinness said she doesn't look like a nurse, because I think the people at Guinness had perhaps been watching different videos of nurses than the training ones now on offer. And she rightly appealed this, and she now is the quickest nurse in the business. I mean, this is your area, so, I mean, you must know.
Well, yes, yes, it is my area, kind of.
You help
obviously not running. I did do a walk from Hull to Liverpool for support relief. Yeah, that was pretty amazing, because that was, like, 20 miles a day for a week. And they did tell me that I would burn 6,000 calories a day. Unfortunately, I ate 9,000 a day, This nurse is called Jessica Anderson, and you were right, she was wearing trousers, OK? As you said, she was ineligible, because that's not
what... She was wearing scrubs, wasn't
she? Scrubs, that's right, yeah. According to Guinness, the guidelines said a proper nurse's uniform should include a pinafore and a cap. when did they write those rules? 1850s? Actually, the Daily Mail helpfully provided us with a photo of a marathon-running nurse that falls within Guinness guidelines. Here we are. What actually made them change their mind about her world record?
Which, didn't she appeal?
She did. She pointed out the inherent sexism, and they released a statement saying, "Our guidelines were outdated, incorrect, and reflected a stereotype we do not in any way wish to perpetuate." Even though they just did. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Am I meant to be doing this again? I've kind of...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we've still got a bit more of this, haven't we? Thanks, Paul.
No, we like seeing it.
Oh, what? Do you?
Yeah.
Well, that was completely out of sync.
Yeah, that was terrible. Hang on.
No. That
was
to do that.
Quite bad.
That was quite bad. You'd have to do it all again.
This is a shambles.
Hang on, what's going on, Steve? We can't replace her now. What are you talking about? Too late.
Put the hammer down.
My husband often says that to me. OK. Fingers on buzzers, teams.
This is a story about someone who stole a piece of Stonehenge. Mm. And you just thought they would have noticed. I mean, look, there he is. wasn't very subtle about it. He kept it and he took it to America and he's finally returned it because after all these decades, he's got bored of a bit of stone.
His name's Robert Phillips. He stole it in the 1950s when a restoration team drilled metal supports into some of the stones to keep them in position. He's just turned 90, kept it as a memento. Why is he returning it after 60 years?
Was he sick of cars slowing down in front of his house to have a look?
he was worried about what would happen to it after his death. The sarsen stone. Don't ask me what a sarsen stone is. It just says it's a type of...
It's one of the stones. Mm. The different types. Mm. The standing okay. ones and sarsen ones. And
mm. The top ones.
What a dork.
You're not denying
that's,
it.
That's a completely different type of stone, which is around the perimeter.
Do you like Stonehenge?
I love Stonehenge. I used to go there when you could go up there and help in the building.
What? Fingers on buzzers, teams. This is Jamie Oliver. He's got into trouble because he's come up for a recipe for paella, which the Spaniards don't agree is paella, and so he's got into trouble because of that.
Because he's added chorizo.
Chorizo.
Uh-oh, chorizo.
Yeah.
Bad. I don't know what that is.
Plus, some people don't find it very appetising because it's got a picture of his face right in the middle of it.
Some of the abuse was pretty bad, eh? They said, why don't you go and make chicken nuggets out of your own fingers?
Yeah, a Spanish man, Antonio Villarreal, tweeted, my version of fish and chips combines aubergine with duck. And one Daily Mail commenter added, Jamie, I voted for Brexit because you said you would leave the country if we won. Why are you still here? But why? Why are people so angry?
This is cultural appropriation, which, you know,
but
essentially...
I've had chorizo in paella in Spain. In lots of the... like.
Yeah,
lots
but
of times.
You are not allowed to say this is my recipe for paella because you're not Spanish. Like, if you cook spaghetti bolognese, anyone who cooks it tonight is guilty of cultural appropriation. The only thing we are allowed to cook is fish fingers. That is Britain in Brexit future.
You should just have called it paella a la Gibraltar, and then... No, why, your wife is Spanish, Nick.
Yes.
What would happen if you put a bit of chorizo in the paella?
Oh, well, there are very strict rules what should and shouldn't go into a paella. And
finally, something Nick's expert on.
Can anyone tell me what Jamie has named his newborn son?
Is it food-related?
Yeah.
Basil.
Oh,
non-stick frying pan.
George Foreman.
Time now for the odd one out round. Blackbeard, Andy Hamilton, Conan the Barbarian, and Ian Hislop. There you are.
Well, they've all got beards, except me.
So,
thank you very much. 2 points.
They're all barbarians, except me.
How dare you?
It's just
you,
what
sir?
A barbarian would say.
Is it pirates?
Mmm.
I'm a pirate in a children's cartoon.
You are exactly, yes.
Mm. So,
do you remember what you're called?
I'm called... Yes, of course I remember. I'm a proper artist.
Yeah.
I'm Captain Squid.
You are, you're Captain Squid.
Captain Squid.
I'm a captain and I'm a squid. It's actually quite an achievement for a squid to reach that rank.
What's your Captain Squid voice? Your booming pirate voice?
It's very like this voice.
This is about having a parrot. I had a parrot when I was young.
Ian's the odd one out, he's not a pirate.
Yes, you're right. Ian has never been a pirate, but like many legendary pirates, he did once own a parrot. What was your parrot called?
We were a very imaginative family. Oh, it was called Polly. It was a grey African parrot.
Did you teach it all your catchphrases?
And those would be, Alexander?
Yes. I don't know, catch looks, maybe.
We had this parrot in Nigeria where we were living when I was very young, and it was a lovely parrot, and it did a certain amount of talking in English.
Mm.
I'm too good for this place. I really shouldn't be here.
Yeah.
What do we know about Blackbeard?
He used to set fire to himself, didn't he?
He did.
Yeah, he used to put fireworks in his beard.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. He would weave wicks laced with gunpowder into his hair and lit them during battle. Here he is. Got a picture of him.
He runs a coffee shop now in Shoreditch. I've seen him.
it's vaping. That's still happening.
Blackbeard was an infamous 18th century pirate in the Caribbean, known for his drunkenness and violent reputation. In fact, Johnny Depp used him as an inspiration for the character Johnny Depp in real life. who's that playing Conan the Barbarian?
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yes. That's right. One recent review of Conan the Barbarian read simply, terrible film, terrible actor, terrible apprentice ratings, sad, exclamation mark. yes, they are all pirates apart from Ian, although he did once own a parrot.
I was a pirate, actually. After Nigeria, we moved to Somalia. The article Captain Phillips is based on me.
At last, something I know about. This is Nando's.
Well done!
Any yes, idea? But I bet you don't know where it is.
Yeah, that's got him.
There was a survey done in Preston. Did you read this? What's the favourite restaurant of people in Preston?
Yes.
And the answer was Nando's.
Yeah.
Obviously. And after that, it said, what's the favourite pub? And it's Wetherspoons.
Who was specifically annoyed that the award went to Nando's, though?
Some other people who own restaurants?
Yeah. It was the guy who came second. He's got an independent restaurant. Mark O'Rourke, he's called. He told The Times, it just makes Preston look bad, adding, not that it isn't anyway. It's not a crown jewel of the Northwest. Do you know what his restaurant was called? It's a burger bar, and yes, it's a pun.
I can't believe it's not Nando's.
No, any other guesses?
Bugger me burgers.
The Burgers of Calais.
Right, I'm going to put you out.
Is it a Rodin pub?
Yeah.
They'll it's, get there.
It's named We Don't Give a Fork. The awards organiser, Mark Whittle, defended the wins for Nando's and Wetherspoons, saying, it's good to recognise them publicly. They are the very reason many people visit Preston. Why else might people visit Preston?
The other thing I know about Preston is its pioneering economic model as a way to deal with economic depression rather than having council services run by big corporations. They decided to give all their council contracts to local business and cooperatives, and it's actually done a lot to regenerate the region. So
do you know what? The Preston PR team are going to be so happy with you.
I'm actually on that paper.
Yeah, because it's not that at all. Yeah. It's a... Preston resident Diane Fisher wrote to the Times comments section to say it has a smashing bus station. Yeah. Have a look at it, though. It is lovely.
Whoa.
Yeah. Underlying its status as a culinary hotspot, what was Preston the first place in Britain to have?
Burger King.
No.
KFC.
Yes. In 1965, Preston became the first place in Britain to have a Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Wow.
Yeah.
Never been.
It's a reason to go, though.
Yeah.
Put it on your bucket list.
Finally, why has Whole Earth peanut butter been taken off supermarket shelves?
Because it's not what it says it is.
It's because its ingredients label says it contains walnuts, but accidentally they've written that in Dutch. So people might not be able to tell there's walnuts in it. Does anybody know what the Dutch is for walnuts?
Hofmeister.
Walnut.
Walnut.
You can see the problem, can't
you? Yeah, that could confuse a stupid person.
Yeah. For the end of Wayne Hennessy if he's got a walnut allergy. Yeah.
And so to round two, the picture spin quiz. Mm. Fingers on buzzers, teams.
This is the very irate people of Cornwall who are upset that weathermen are standing in front of their part of the nation.
She's not, though.
No.
She's got the hang of it.
This is Cornwall-compliant weather forecasting, by the way.
It looks as though it's very hot in Cornwall, though.
The Isles...
Quite like to go.
Absolutely right. I think we should have a look at some examples that have been cited by the people of Cornwall. Mm. Here's the first one. And then there's this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And finally, how far have the Cornish complaints gone?
To London.
all the way to the top of the Cornish Tourism Board. Mm. The head of Visit Cornwall, Malcolm Bell, met with the BBC and Met Office officials for Clear the Air talks this week. BBC weather presenters are now standing well back from the map.
They've stuck a great big nine on it now, though. They won't be happy with that.
Why might the Met Office change the way it names storms?
Oh, if you've got a storm with a female name, people don't take it quite so seriously. This is what I've heard.
Spot on.
Storm Elsie, they don't take any notice of that, but Storm Roger, they're more worried about.
Absolutely. They believe storms given female names are more dangerous because people take them less seriously.
That's not the experience in my house, I have to say.
Well...
nor mine.
Let's test that out.
Let's test it out.
Which storm would you be more afraid of, Storm Tim or Storm Janie?
Storm Janie.
Janie.
That's unanimous. How did the wrong camera angle cause embarrassment for Sky Sports this week? It's a cracker, this. It was an unfortunate moment on Sky Sports when presenter Kelly Cates hands over to former footballers Gary Neville and Jamie Carragher. Let's take a look at this remarkably subtle bit of TV direction.
After three wins in four, particularly after the win against Brighton, we're expecting he's going to be in a good mood. How significant was that last win?
It was a huge win. I mean,
that's done as a joke, surely.
No.
I think really? It was the way the direction, the camera angle were taking it from, but she was expecting it to happen, I think.
Right, right, yeah.
Who's not happy with South London Football Club, Sydenham United?
Their oldest fan, Sid Ham. Doesn't like the way they've taken his name.
No, sadly not.
No.
London rivals Streatham Rovers, who tweeted this ahead of a meeting between the two teams this week. Here's the team sheet for tonight's game, and we are absolutely furious because Sydney fielded their players to spell out SRFC are shit.
That's beautiful.
Streatham went on to tweet, "Glad some of you are finding this amusing, but I'll tell you what, the gaffer has stuck this up in our changing room and that's it. No need for a team talk. The players will be well up for this." They lost 3-1. This is the Cornish Tourist Board complaining about BBC weather presenters. A spokesman for Visit Cornwall said the problem was that people watch the forecast and make snap judgments about whether or not they will travel down for short breaks. To which a spokesman for Visit Salisbury replied, "You think you've got problems?"